Golden Dawn was once the third most popular party in Greece. Now a court has sentenced its leaders to more than a decade behind bars. But can their fascist ideology be locked away with them? I'm Ali Aslan, and today on The Newsmakers, we look at whether this Greek conviction sends a message to Europe's far right. They say politics is a dirty game, but Golden Dawn took things to a whole new level. Under the guise of a political party, the group committed assault, murder, and even human trafficking. Now they've been defeated by a court case. But what about their ideology? Remember, this is a movement that once won 18 seats in Greece's parliament. And they're not the only far-right group to have enjoyed success in Europe. Hungary, Italy, Spain, and Germany have all seen xenophobic parties do well. But could this guilty verdict for Golden Dawn be a sign of things to come for violent neo-Nazis across the continent? Or will the far right continue to rise? Adam Platz reports.
Greece's neo-fascist political party, Golden Dawn, has been convicted of running a criminal organization. A court in Athens found that its leaders had been directly responsible for ordering attacks against migrants and left-wing opponents.
Με τη σημερινή απόφαση του τριμελούς εφετείου κακουργημάτων και τη δράση της Χρυσής Αυγής κλείνει ένας τραυματικός κύκλος της δημόσιας ζωής της χώρας. Η πολιτική του διάσταση έχει ευτυχώς κρυφθεί με τη νίκη της δημοκρατίας που εξόρισε από τη Βουλή το ναζιστικό μόρφωμα. Τώρα η ανεξάρτητη δικαιοσύνη δίνει και αυτή.
In 2012, during the Greek financial crisis, Golden Dawn won 7% of the vote in national elections, coming in third place and giving it 18 members of parliament, all of whom were among those convicted. But a year later, a Golden Dawn member admitted to murdering Pavlo Fisa, an anti-fascist musician. Golden Dawn's leadership was arrested and a trial began in 2015, with charges including murder, possession of weapons, and involvement in the disappearance of as many as 100 immigrants. By 2019, the party had lost popularity and failed to reach Greece's 3% threshold for parliamentary participation, losing all its seats. The party may now be finished, but there's a danger its ideology will live on, as Golden Dawn's leader has previously suggested.
Neither bullets nor prison can bend nationalists. And the greatest proof of that is this rally with all of you fellow fighters here.
A new, but less extreme far-right party, the Greek Solution, was founded in 2016 and holds 10 seats in the Hellenic Parliament. And Europe's most populous and powerful countries have significant far-right political representation in their national assemblies. In Hungary, the ideology of Viktor Orbán's ruling Fidesz party is frequently described as soft fascism. More extreme movements, like Germany's Pegida and the English Defence League, have no political representation, but share a similar ideology to Golden Dawn. Does Greece's ruling send a message to Europe's rising far right that their extremist ideology will no longer be tolerated? And if prosecution is a possibility, could the days of the far right be numbered? Adam Pletz, The Newsmakers.
To help answer that, I am joined now by European Parliament Vice President Dimitrios Papadimoulis. He is also the head of the Syriza delegation in Brussels. Politics professor Daphne Halikiopoulou is an expert in Europe's far right at the University of Reading. She's also the author of The Golden Dawn's Nationalist Solution, Explaining the Rise of the Far Right in Greece. And Eva Cosse is a Human Rights Watch's researcher for Western Europe. Welcome to you all. Dimitrios, the neo-fascist group Golden Dawn has been found guilty of operating a gang of hit squads with the aim of eliminating enemies. As a matter of fact, the court basically called it a criminal organization in disguise. And today, its leadership has been sentenced to 13 years in prison. Is this a good day for Greece?
It's a great day, a great of joy. It's a victory of democracy, a victory of the rule of law against fascism, against neo-Nazi criminal gang and against the criminal violence. And I think that now it's up to us to continue in that path, strengthening democracy, parliamentary democracy, the rule of law, and creating a total political and ethical isolation for the extreme right and its violence.
A good day for Greece, says Dimitrios. Daphne, interestingly enough, this court case against the Golden Dawn started 5 years ago, a little over 5 years, as a matter of fact. Why did it take the court so long to come down with these rulings?
Indeed, very long. So I will agree that it's a very good day for Greece and a very good day for democracy. But we should be concerned about the fact that a lot of the Golden Dawn's actions were at least tolerated in the past, and the fact that the trial took so long. I think it took so long for a variety of reasons, the same reasons that the criminal actions in the past were, as I said, at the very least tolerated. So I think that while the decision is fundamental and very important for Greek democracy, we do at the moment need to take a step back as a country and understand why we voted this party into our parliament in the first place, and why its actions were tolerated in our country for so long.
Indeed, if we look at the party founder alone, Michal Oliakos, he's been a known Holocaust denier and admirer of Hitler. All these things should have rang the alarm bell a long time ago, no?
Absolutely. And the Golden Dawn did not appear in the country in 2012. It had operated in the past, started off as a bulletin. It was an organization that used to operate as a grassroots movement on the streets. So everybody knew its existence. Everybody knew that these people perpetrated violent acts, and they had not been persecuted. In fact, they were roaming around doing these things until the murder of Pavlos Fissas, which was in many ways the catalyst for the increasing attention to the criminal activities, and then finally the court, the long trial and the court ruling. So as I said, I do think that we need to consider both the systemic, the structural, as well as the political reasons that led to the toleration of these kinds of activities for so long in Greece.
Eva, the court has clearly ruled that the group has been found guilty of sowing hate, poisoning Greek society, and orchestrating murderous attacks. At the end of the day, it's hard to fathom now in 2020 that this is a party that at the height of the debt crisis was the third biggest political force in Greece, isn't it?
Yes, it is. I'm one of the researchers that launched a big research back in 2010 and 11, documenting what we called back then the epidemic of racist violence that was going on in Greece. And back then, we were met by Greek authorities, by the society, by regular Greeks with disbelief that this is going on in Greece. At the same time, we were documenting dozens and dozens of attacks in the streets of Athens with complete impunity. So it's not just about convicting the party and the members of the party, but looking also at the failures in terms of the police response back then, the judiciary, the fact that not even one case was reaching the courts. Of course, these have changed now, and they have changed with lots of work from civil society, from lawyers, from journalists who reported about what's happening back then.
Dimitrios, we all know that Greece suffered greatly economically throughout the debt crisis, but other countries in Europe also had their fair share of economic hardship and didn't vote for fascist parties. How do you explain the allure and appeal of the Golden Dawn, particularly during those years, in that time, for Greek voters?
I think that during the collapse of the Greek economy and the Greek society, there was a ground for the neo-Nazi party of Golden Dawn to make their propaganda. But before today's verdict of the court ruling, there was the first punishment of the Golden Dawn 1 year and a half ago in the elections. The Greek citizens, had decided to kick out of the Greek parliament the Golden Dawn. And now we are, as Greeks, in the front line of reducing the power of such criminal and extreme organization, because the extreme right is rising all over Europe, all over the world. I agree that the Golden Dawn is the more extreme right party. And so in the political group of the extreme right in the European Parliament, Marine Le Pen and Salvini had rejected the participation of Golden Dawn in their political group. But there is no one Europe totally democratic without an extreme right. And I am proud that although 7-8 years ago, the Golden Dawn became the third party of our parliament, now the Golden Dawn is outside the parliament, but it's probably the political death of Golden Dawn, but not of the extreme right, either in Greece, either in the European Union, either in Turkey, either in the whole world. So I think that the lesson from the Greek court is that we have to continue fighting against that ideas and mainly against that criminal actions, because the court's ruling was not against their ideas, but against their criminal actions. There were murderers. And I agree that the turning point for the Greek justice system, for the Greek government, was the murder of a Greek rapper, Pavlos Fissas. Before that, there was a lot of murders from the Golden Dawn to immigrants, to refugees, and nothing was happened really. The turning point was the shock of murdering a Greek rapper, Pavlos Fissas. And I think that we owe a lot of respect to Pavlos Fissas and to his family, because they gave a big fight for democracy, for dignity, for the rule of law, not only for the Greeks, but for all the Democrats all over the world.
And Pavlos Fissas' murder has been sentenced to a lifetime as well today. Certainly that's also justice for Fissas' relatives, but for Greece in general. Definitely, Dimitrios has mentioned Salvini, Le Pen. The list, unfortunately, is long. In Europe, of course, and all of those have in common that they are accused of targeting immigrants, anti-fascist, leftists, and homosexuals. But Golden Dawn has gone much further than this, hasn't they?
Yes, so I think what is distinct about the type of far-right party, i.e. the Golden Dawn, the rose in Greece, in that this is an openly Nazi, an openly fascist party that adopts violence, and indeed, as Dimitrios said, it was indicted for its criminal activities, not its ideology. And so I think I'm skeptical about the fact that the statement that the economic crisis alone led to the rise of this type of far-right party. And that's because, as you said correctly, that many of the countries in Europe also experienced the economic crisis. Spain is one of them, Portugal, Ireland, but they didn't develop a far-right, and especially not that type of far-right. So I think that we need to look further. And what distinguishes Greece from these other countries is that, in a way, the economic crisis that we experienced culminated into a broader political crisis and a crisis of democratic representation. So I think that one thing that needs to concern us is whether people voted for the Golden Dawn despite its violent extremism or because its violent extremism represented an anti-systemicness, represented their anti-establishment attitudes. And so now I think that that is something very different to what is going on elsewhere in Europe, the Marine Le Pen's of this Europe, that basically, as you say, suggest that we need to restore sovereignty, we need to restore national sovereignty in the name of the people, and we need to have some sort of anti-immigrant policies or restrictions to immigration, but not adopt violence and extremism the way the Golden Dawn did. And so while I think that the Golden Dawns of Europe are declining, this is not necessarily the case for the other type of far right, precisely because this other type of far right is dressed in a more palatable narrative, if you like, that is not stigmatized by fascist violence the same way as the Golden Dawn is.
Eva, this trial has been watched closely by European countries and far right parties indeed. Do you think this impact of this verdict will be felt far beyond Greece's borders?
Yes, I believe so, because, I mean, racist crimes are intended to send a message to those they attack that you are not welcome within Greece, Greek society or society as a whole. And when justice responds, justice sends a counter message that is very strong and that says that this kind of violence, racism, intolerance, will not be tolerated within society. If you do these crimes, you will be punished. And I hope that this will have a long-term impact, not just in Greece, but also in other European countries. I just want to go back a little bit about what led to Golden Dawn flourishing back in 2010, 11, 12. Because it's very connected with what's happening now. Back then, we had a government that was stigmatizing migrants, that had abandoned the center of Athens, where you had dozens of migrants and asylum seekers sleeping rough in the streets of Athens and in squares, with very little provision about the reception of these people. At the same time, there was inadequate policing in the center of Athens, an increase in petty crimes, and the media constantly reporting about, you know, migrants committing crimes, stealing, etc. This was fertile ground for Golden Dawn to flourish. And this is something that we see today again with the current government in Greece. They are stigmatizing migrants, talking about invasion. They are letting them, you know, live in unacceptable conditions on the Greek islands. And the media reproduced these images of fight, of violence in the camp, that sends a message to Greek society that these people are dangerous, that we are in danger, and that could potentially, you know, give the space to a new far-right movement party to develop. So it's very important for the leaders of this country to be careful in the language they use. Back then, the Prime Minister Samaras was describing Syrian refugees as illegal clandestine migrants. And today, the Prime Minister and the Minister of Migration gives the same description about those who are coming to Greece to seek refuge. At the same time, they also attack civil society and NGOs. There is some demonization of NGOs, which is further fueling this anti-immigrant, anti-civil society sentiment in Greece.
Right. Dimitrios, picking up on what Eva was saying, do you fear that, because Greece is obviously one of the countries in Europe hardest hit by the refugee crisis, it had to take and shoulder a huge burden. And one might say that the potential, the Golden Dawn may be outlawed and sentenced, but the potential for that kind of thinking and the school of thought might still be there. Are you fearful? Are you concerned that another political movement might scoop up those votes?
Yes, there is a possible scenario, because the end of the Golden Dawn doesn't mean that there is the end of the extreme right or of the racism or discrimination against others or refugees, immigrants, or minorities in the society. So I think that it's important to work on that, changing the mind of people, but also giving solutions in the problem. We need a European answer in the refugee crisis, in the refugee flows. We need a European answer in the migration policy, not 27 different asylum policies. And we need also a better cooperation between Greece and Turkey, between European Union and Turkey, instead of tensions and provocations or illegal actions in the neighborhood, it is important to cooperate, because according to all the studies, we have to live with phenomena like the refugee flow. And on that, the wrong answers from the government, the wrong rhetoric, as Eva said, created, cultivated the ground for parties, criminal gangs like Golden Dawn. So it's up to all the democratic parties from the left until the right, the center right, but the parliamentary right, to create a very strong front against fascism, against criminal violence, based on values of parliamentary democracy, of the respect of the rule of law. And I think that this is the only way to fight against the extreme right and its violence.
And speaking of that strong front, Daphne, you've already established and confirmed that the Golden Dawn cannot be compared to any traditional or conventional far-right party out there in Europe. But do you think that the verdict and the way it's been handled sends a message and perhaps even a lesson to other European countries on how they can deal with their own fringes of far-right movements and political parties?
I think it sends a message that criminal activities and anti-democratic activities will not be tolerated. And if I'm not mistaken, already Slovakia has had a similar indictment of a far-right or fascist party there of the leader. And so this is certainly a message for extreme violent acts, but I don't think that this message applies to parties that operate within the confines of liberal democracy. There, the actions are different, and there the policies are different. As you rightly said, and I agree with everyone who said that, attitudes are not always channeled into support for a particular political party. The question why is how we can limit support for certain parties that we think may be transmitting some kind of exclusionary ideology, right? So some kind of, insecurity in society needs to be addressed through policies that will make people feel more secure about their welfare, more secure about their position in society, so they won't express their anti-systemic anger against the system, say by voting for a fringe party. And so this is very, very important. But at the same time, indictment, I think, and court rulings are confined to groupings and parties that engage in violent anti-democratic acts.
If I think, while we all agree that the court ruling is a very good one, a jubilant one for Greece and Europe, I think it's too soon, no, to speak of the beginning of the end of far-right movements and parties in Europe.
Yes, I agree. I mean, what was smart with what happened in Greece in the indictment is the fact that, as the other said, it was not the political party that was banned or attacked, because it's not allowed in the Greek constitution, which is actually very good. But what the prosecutors did, which was very smart, was to, you know, argue that within this political party, there is a criminal organization operating. And this criminal organization has a military structure with a leader, a clear line of command, and they are committing and orchestrating hate crimes, attacks against migrants, asylum seekers, the murders of Pavlos Fissas, of Sherzad Lukman, a 27-year-old Pakistani national. And I think this is why this verdict and trial is extremely important, because it's not an attack against, you know, the right to association, free speech, expression. It focuses on the criminal acts.
Dimitrios, this traumatic episode, thankfully, has been put to rest now in Greece with the end of the Golden Dawn. Do you think that the country and its citizens have and will derive the right lessons from this episode?
There is a poll, there's a public research during that days. 83% of the Greeks are satisfied with the court's ruling. 73%, 76% think that the danger coming from the extreme right ideas remains. And 21% of the Greek citizens could support a more severe golden dawn without criminal activity, but with similar ideas. So I think that there is a large democratic anti-extreme right, anti-fascist majority
right
in the Greek society, but also there is a ground for alternative voices, softer than the criminal golden dawn, to be active also in Greece.
Right.
And
the ground is
ready to have softer extreme right parties in Greece, like Salvini or Le Pen. And it's up to us to avoid that scenario.
Unfortunately, we have to leave it at there, but it still remains. This is a good time for Greece, good day for Greece, good day for justice. Daphne, Dimitrios, and Eva, thank you so much for shedding light and commenting on the Golden Dawn court case and its ramifications for Europe. And thank you out there for watching. Hope to see you again next time when we're back with a new edition of Newsmakers.